I'm going to try to do this quickly because we are running out of time. Anthony will hold me to 15 minutes. Close that notebook or leave it, set it aside. Go to the GeoPandas advanced notebook, open it up and change the kernel like we did before to vector env. And then I will try not to read, not to go through all the background materials and just get to the code. The loading of libraries is pretty much the same as before. So we'll just click through those things quickly. Again, we'll load the credentials for PostgreSQL and PostGIS because we'll be loading a data set, a fairly large data set that some of you, like David, may find useful. At least David and Catherine will know what a hydrobasin is. Our sample data set here will be watersheds, starting out with a data set that is has hierarchical watersheds across the world, for the whole world, I believe. It is stored in the same cloud instance of PostGIS, and it's built up out of fine resolution watersheds with a coding system that encodes that hierarchy. So it allows us to aggregate into larger watersheds.
You can read whatever is written in there. We'll use the connection mechanism that we used before, where we're using the credentials.
There's one distinction. We're using the same read PostGIS function, but previously we loaded the entire data set without any filtering. What we're going to do here is use SQL code, pretty simple SQL code. You can see the where statement in the SQL string to pull in just one quote-unquote watershed based on this hierarchical code. So we're pulling a subset from a global data set on this big cloud instance, and only the set of watersheds that we want, because you don't want to pull, when you're interacting with the cloud into your local environment or other cloud, you don't want to be grabbing big data sets and then just to subset them on your end. Preferably, you want to push as much work to the server. So that's what we're doing here. We're saying we're only interested in Western Washington. We know what the codes are, so we're going to only pull out and I run it. It's going to take a bit because maybe not that much. We're only putting this subset. And don't worry about not knowing what FAT4 is. And obviously, I knew in advance what 7381 or 7831 FAT4 was. And that got us 413 polygons. I used this syntax that I used before without explaining it, idlock, that gives us the first record or the first feature in the geodata frame. Just to give you a quick taste of the attributes that come in, all these FAF attributes are this hierarchical coding of watershed by scale. So you can see how it grows from the FAF1 is, northern, I don't even know what that is. But the FAF12 is the most detailed, smallest units, the actual individual polygons. And this is what it looks like. We use the same plotting tools or mechanisms we used before, using categorical plotting and an aggregated column so that you can see in color, you're seeing an aggregated or the polygon colors and aggregated watersheds. But the individual boundaries that you're seeing in white are the actual individual polygons. So we still have a single plot statement, but we're doing something fancier than what we did before to view the hierarchies of watersheds. So this notebook is all about more advanced examples of more advanced functionality. We are going to do the solve. I hear this is known by different names, union, in other contexts. But if you're coming from an ArcGIS background, this is the lingo that's used. And fortunately, it's adopted also in GeoPandas. You can see that I define what columns I want to retain from that long list of columns. I pass it here to this geodata frame, apply the dissolve overlay method, and pass the specific arguments. I can answer questions about this later so that I can keep moving. So that runs, that ran. So now by applying that dissolve, I turned 413 watersheds or polygons into a new geodata frame with 13 records. And what I'm doing here basically is turning all the individual little watersheds, quote unquote, dissolving the boundaries between them when they belong to the same larger watershed that you see there in the sharing the same color. So the new geodata frame that we just created on the fly
well, again, it has 13 records, has far fewer attributes, and looks like that solid color.
Now we have different polygons, the aggregated watershed side and the individual polygons.
I won't go into that caveat about invalid geometries, but please read it at some point.
We'll get a taste now at reprojection from GeoPandas
and other complementary tools that from Python that you can use. So the
CRS, we pre-assigned when we read the data set from PostGIS, we assigned the CRS because I knew it.
You can access it and parse it. It's a string, basically. And once I parse it in this statement, I pass it to this PyEPSG module to turn it from
a code, 4326, but it could be something more obscure. 4326 is something you'll memorize by heart if you use that long regularly.
But if you don't know what it is, you have access to this library that
basically turns that code into the more basic information about what projection it actually is.
And there's that information.
I'm going to reproject this into a projection that is very common here in government, especially government, state, and local government in Washington.
I think this is the conventional.
We have someone from a state government here. I forget where he is. State Plane South, 2927. I happen to know what it is. But again, you wouldn't know what 2927 is, so we'll use the same library to give us information about the projection. You can see it there. So again, that was just a taste of tools to be able to see what an EPSG code projection actually is. And now we use the toCRS method on a geodata frame to convert from its own projection to another one based on an EPSG code. Pretty simple.
One step. Now we're just going to create a new map,
just like we've done before, same thing, except now it's in a different projection, and you can see that it looks different. See how the usual lat long flattened look, and now it's in
a more realistic view
in feet,
since
I don't think we have anyone from Canada this time, so, oh, sorry, well, I meant coming from Canada right now to this workshop. You've given up by now.
So anyway, so you can see how easy it was to reproject and to create a new geodata frame where the only difference is that a geometry is in a different projection. And it retained information about what the new projection is. Okay, so because square feet is so unwieldy, if we're going to deal with area, I'm going to turn that into square miles. Sorry, Anthony. So again, we use the area a property that we saw before, and I apply this manual conversion. This is just standard. The fact that we can create a new column based on an operation like that is pretty much standard pandas data frame operations. And then look at the output, new column that we created on the fly. And now we're going to run a choropleth, what official GIS would call a choropleth, I guess, a map where the polygon colors are based on some range, or treated as values rather than categorical maps. Using matplot machinery we've seen before, set a title and a column name. In this case, we used a scheme instead of a categorical type. We define which scheme for breaking up the categories we're going to use, Fisher-Jenks, and how many categories, 7, or how many classes. So 7 classes. And the rest is stuff you've seen. The rest is sort of prettifying it. So you can see here that, well, Fisher-Jenks, I believe, selects equal
interval classes
divided into 7 from the minimum value to the maximum value. And you can see that now
we're seeing a map that instead of seeing categorical information shows ranges
because we're dealing with data now,
area.
Not very interesting data, but data nevertheless.
But that's a static map. We can also use other tools that are available in Python and in notebooks to create something more interactive.
So we'll use Folium And someone, Randy or others, will cover Folium later in the week to create an interactive map within the notebook. You can see here that's the same concept. It's a core plath. We can click on one of these things and zoom in. And because it has a background map, it's not a simple static map, but it's fixed scale. So you can interact with it even in the context of this notebook and see the background layers and so on. Now I'm going to demonstrate a join by using one of the files, these geospatial files found within that data folder. In this case, a geopackage file, but it doesn't matter what the format is because geopandas will handle it. So this happens to be a data set that Don and I manage. It's an old static version of coastal monitoring stations. So same context, we just pull it out. It has 194 records. They're all points. Here are the attributes. And that's what they look like in lat long. Here's the Pacific Northwest. You are here somewhere. I'm going to join that to the watersheds. So you can see the GeoPandas data frame tools module, the S-join or spatial join. We have the new point geodata frame, the watershed geodata frame using an inner join. If you're coming from a relational database world, this should be very familiar, which means that points that don't overlap a polygon from the watersheds will drop out. This is an intersect, essentially. So when we run that, we're left with 63 points out of the 194 that we had, because many of them are out in the sea and don't overlap with watersheds. And now we're just going to map it the same way we have mapped things, except that we have the watersheds background. So you can now we have the outcome of a spatial join. Or viewing the outcome. Now we're going to end with a segue into Raster. Raster Stats is a cool little module or library that allows you to do zonal statistics. For those of you who don't use Raster or Raster GIS, basically you take an area or a polygon and apply it on a raster, whatever it is, and extract statistics, like the mean precipitation, for example, or any other statistics. So first, we're going to read one particular raster, a TIFF of July precipitation in the Pacific Northwest. We read it. No, I just created the file path. And we use Rasterio for reading it. I won't go into it. But I've opened it. Here's the metadata. And here's what that raster looks like for Washington. Almost there. And now we use Raster Stats. So right now, all of that was just pure raster. We read a TIFF, or GeoTIFF. Provided a quick snapshot, and now we load raster stats, and here's where the magic happens, except for a caveat that raster stats, the current version, kind of requires or hardwires the geometry column from the geodata frame. It has to be called geometry. So we actually have to rename the geometry column and do these two steps in the geodata frame before we can pass it on to raster stats. OK, so here's the magic. We use the zonal stats method. Here's the geodata frame of watersheds, the dissolved watersheds, the rasterio raster data set, which is essentially a NumPy array. It will return a GeoJSON object. Well, it's done. So 17 records. It's not a geodata frame, but you can turn that just like we had with the web service response at the end of the other notebook. We can take a GeoJSON-like object and turn it into a geodata frame very easily with the from features constructor. So here we do that, and now we're back to our familiar geodata frame. So now you see we have the watershed polygons, the attributes from that watershed geodata frame, and the statistics for each polygon derived from the raster, the July precipitation. Count, I didn't specify which statistics I wanted, so I got them all. Count, or the default one, count, max, mean, and min. And I will do a more interesting choropleth. Same approach for generating the map, except that now we have something far more interesting than area, than polygon area. We have precipitation in July, or mean precipitation in July, out of climatology for that watershed. I guess Fisher-Jenks was an equal interval. Sorry for what I said earlier. It's a different scheme. It sounded weird when I said it, but here I'm using a much more obvious name or a scheme, equal interval, with five categories. And I guess I already generated it. So a lot went into this. We loaded a data set from PostGIS that happened to be on the cloud. We applied a filter server side to only get a subset. We dissolved into larger watersheds. We reprojected in order to get the area in square miles from lat long. And then we interacted with the raster data set and back into the vector world. That's it.